I love you too, baby. Good morning.
How you doing?
Kind of chilly out here.
Yeah, it is.
But it's a good morning. Why don't you go look for something? Go hunt a rabbit or something. It is a good morning. And by the way, welcome back to the farm. Today's episode is going to be kind of funny, but it's also going to be very serious. There is something new here, and I wanted to introduce it to you. I want you to be the first ones to see this because it's something very special to me, and it's something that I believe is very worthwhile. I want to bring them out. But first, I want to tell you a little story. And I know some people really enjoy my stories. Some folks don't. But I would like to ask you, if you would just do me a favor, give me a moment to tell this story because it's very, very important. And it explains a lot of who I am, what I do, and what the past is and what the future is going to be with my experience here on the farm. And I spent about a week or two thinking about this before I even decided to film this program. So you can imagine that it is very important. So I'm going to get, oh, by the way, I got a new mug. I'm so happy about this. And I wanted to thank the person who sent me the big box of happiness. Thank you, Marianne from Massachusetts. I really do appreciate it. This is my new mug. And I got to show you this. Hold on. Okay. This made me happy. Don't you love it? Don't you love it? That is fantastic. I love that. I opened up the box, saw this, and I hurried up and washed it out and filled it full of cranberry juice. Yes, it's full of cranberry juice. I normally would have this full of coffee, but I've already drank my coffee and I wanted to get out here, so I got cranberry juice in here. Cranberry juice is a wonderful thing in the morning. Well, I'm going to get to what I want to talk to you about, okay? I'm going to try and make this as easy as possible. And you're really going to like this. I want to tell you a story. And this is a true story. Of course, all of my stories are. When I was 19 years old, I lived in Garden City, Kansas. Southwest Kansas. It's in the middle of nowhere. I was raised there, by the way. Very small town. And there really wasn't much for me to do there. And I had this thing that I wanted to be connected with animals, and I really didn't know how to go about it. And throughout my whole life, I'd been adopting stray animals. And when I was younger, I really didn't have the information, the knowledge to be able to do it properly. And when I was 19, I was working as a part-time dishwasher at a place called Southwind Country Club. I lived in this real teeny tiny, 1.5-room apartment above a head shop. Yes, it was called the Yankee Doodler, and they sold pot-smoking paraphernalia, and there were apartments above it, the cheapest apartments in town. Now, mind you, I am old, so back in the day when I was 19, rent was a lot cheaper, but then again, I was working for minimum wage, and minimum wage was only $2.25 an hour. Yeah, that's not very much money, and you're working part-time, so I could barely keep myself fed. My rent was $75 a month, so you can imagine, even back then, that was cheap. So you can imagine how bad this apartment was. I can't even go into describing how bad it was. Let's just say it was the worst apartment you've ever seen in your life, but it was my home. And I worked part-time as a dishwasher. One of my only outlets of happiness was to go to the dog pound and look at the dogs. I liked that. I enjoyed that so much. I would go to the dog pound. Garden City had one dog pound. And back then, they didn't have these no-kill shelters. They didn't have rescues. They had dog pounds. When an animal, dog or cat, went to the dog pound, they had 14 days. They would keep them in a small cage for 14 days. If those dogs or cats were not claimed in 14 days, they would euthanize them. They would put them to sleep. That's a nice way of saying they'd kill those animals. And I'm not going to go into the morality of all this. I'm just going to tell you what the facts were. This is the reality of what I lived with. And I would go and I would just look at the animals and think about what the animals were like and what their circumstances were for being there, you know. They all had their stories to tell, and they couldn't tell it. They would just bark and bark, and everybody wanted to be noticed. And I got to know the girl who worked at the dog pound. She went to school with me when I was in high school. So she would let me go into the cages. And I had this repertoire with the animals. I would be able to go into the cages and just sit down. You know, they pooped and peed in their cage. And it was about maybe twice the size of this picnic table. That's how big their cages were. Very, very small. And I would sit on a empty food bowl and just wait and just sit there and talk to them, watch them, and eventually they would come up to me. And I would pet them and I would give them attention. This is all I could do. I could barely afford to take care of myself. So I would communicate with these animals and give them just a little bit of human interaction and a little bit of kindness in the short period of time that they had left over. Also, I worked at, liquid happiness. So as my job as dishwasher, the one way that I could bring them a little bit of happiness, and this was frowned upon by the dog pound, but she was a friend, and she let, when I was a dishwasher, all of the rich people in town would go to this country club. That, it was where all the rich people went. So they'd go to the country club, they'd eat prime rib and steaks and all kinds of fancy food, and of course they don't eat all their food. And so the dishes would come in, and they'd have, like, big pieces of meat and stuff. I talked to the kitchen manager, and he let me take a big trash can, and I would scoop the pieces of meat into the trash bag. And then the next day, I would take it the next morning to the dog pound, and I would deal it out to the dogs. And they were absolutely fantastically, just the expression by them, wagging their tails, because they saw me, and they saw the food, and they would just gulp it down. And they loved it. But it was the least that I could do, but it was all that I could do to help them, because I couldn't adopt them, I couldn't afford them. And what I did this for a while. I did this for about a month or two. And what happened was is that the negativity of this overwhelmed the positivity of the situation. I really liked being able to give them at least a little nugget of humanity before they died. But what really hurt me, and it's still difficult to talk about, is that after 2 weeks, one animal wouldn't be there. And I knew because they did it on a Sunday when they were closed. And Monday, that dog wouldn't be there, that cat wouldn't be there. And I knew what happened. They weren't adopted. And after a while, it got to me personally, and I couldn't do it anymore. I just couldn't do it. I didn't have it inside me to keep saying goodbye. So I quit that. And it was a bad decision, but I had to do it to save myself, because you can only take so much negativity before it overwhelms you. And in my life now, I like to spread as much positivity as I can to try to keep the tide back of negativity. But we all know that when too much negativity comes at you, you can only withstand it for so long. So I stopped doing that. But I wanted to bring that to your attention, because it's the foundation of who I am and what I like to do, and it's something that's very dear to me. People have problems in their day-to-day lives. Animals are my calling, and I try to do as much as I possibly can for the animals that are in my care. Rascal is one of them, the little crackhead. And I call them the little, people that are new don't understand this. Crackhead is a term of endearment. It means nothing bad, okay? But I like to help them out as much as I can. When I lived on the 80 acres, you remember people that have been tuned in since 2008, I lived on 80 acres, and I had six dogs. All of them had their stories. One of them was thrown out of a pickup truck as a puppy. The guy was driving through town, and he just threw a puppy out of the truck. It bounced off the road. A neighbor saw it, took it into the vet. They didn't have, in Bruno, Ascot, Minnesota, they didn't have a dog pound. They didn't have a shelter. The vet was the person where everybody took the strays to, and she didn't know what to do with them, so she would keep them for a while, and she would have to put them down. Of course, she knew me, and I had a couple Great Danes, and she called me. She said, "Ray, I got this thing I need you to see." And she knew I would say, "No, I can't do it. I can't afford it. I don't have the time for it." But I showed up anyway, and I adopted that little puppy that got thrown out and took care of its vet bills and gave it attention. His name was Gus. Then the next dog was found walking around on the interstate. A lady picked him up and had him in her car, and I was out at Banning Junction over by the interstate eating dinner, and I came out, it was dark, and she drove up, and this big dog's all over her, sticking his head out the window, wagging like crazy, knocking her in the face with his tail. She asked me if that was my dog or if I knew anybody who whose dog it was. I said, "No, but if you don't want it, I'll take it," and she gladly gave it to me. That was Buster. Sabrina was the black dog. And those of you who have watched my programs, you know these dogs. I want to explain them to you, okay? This is very important. I think it's very important, so I'm hoping that you'll bear with me. Sabrina was found by one of my employees. I had two retail businesses, some commercial property, and I was invested in the stock market. So I was making a good amount of money at the time. So I could fund this type of behavior and adopting the animals and taking care of them. And Sabrina was found in the middle of winter in Minnesota. And those of you who live in Minnesota or Canada, you know the winters are deadly. And she was half frozen. She was leaning up against the lady's door, and she heard this ruffling up against the door. She opened it up, and this little black half-grown puppy fell in. And she was unconscious. She brought it in, warmed it up, and she called my sister, and my sister called me. So I drove halfway across the state from where I was to St. Paul, and I picked up this dog. That was Sabrina. That was number three. I went to a garage sale. There was a dog chained with a five-foot leash to the side of a barn. I asked the lady when Mike the dishwasher, was looking at some of the stuff. I asked, what's wrong with the dog? She was just laying there with this weird look on her face. She said, I found it. He was just walking down the road, and I think it's dying. So I asked her if she would mind if I took the dog. And she said, please, you have my blessing. I took it into the vet. Turns out she had heartworm, a severe advanced case of heartworm. Heartworm is when these parasites get in there and they infest the heart muscle of the dog, and it usually means death. And, you know, you give those dogs the heartworm medicine, that's to prevent heartworm, okay? This dog already had heartworm. And we took her in there, and they gave her the doggy equivalent of chemotherapy. The vet said she'll either live or she'll die. I can't guarantee which. I would say she has a 50-50 chance of living or dying. And we rolled the dice because I had faith in her. And she lived. That was Ellen. That was my little beagle mix. And the last dog that I had was what I call Little Girl. And she was the most pathetic and the most endearing that I had at that time. We went to an auction. And up in Minnesota, a lot of people will raise dogs and have them on short leashes, and they have a little doghouse, and they're not allowed to play with each other. They're kept away from each other, and they're kept outside. And they use these dogs to pull sleds. That's how some people do it. I'm not saying that's how all people do it. That's how some of the people do it. Well, she was out there in the middle of the sun in the summer, and it was sweltering hot, and she was all of these dogs look the same, okay? But she was this little red tick heeler. Like a blue tick healer, only yellow and gold. And she looked all greasy and dark brown. And we walked over there, and Mike, the dishwasher, he was drawn to her for some reason. He walked up to her. What she did was the saddest thing I've ever seen an animal do. She jumped up, and she wrapped her little paws around his leg, and her eyes got really wide, and she gave him this look, and I'm not kidding you at all. I saw this look, and the only way you can describe this look is, dear God, don't leave me here. And so I went to the auctioneer and find out who the owner was, spoke to him and asked if I could adopt one of his dogs. He said, well, yeah, for about $20, I'll give you any dog you want. So we took her. I paid for her. And the only thing they were feeding them was suet, S-U-E-T. This is like this weird fat type stuff from a rendering plant. He got it free by the container load, and he would throw suet out to them. He didn't feed them regular food. Suet and water is what this dog had, and she lived in a plastic barrel. And so we took her home, and I bought a couple bottles of shampoo because there was no way this dog was coming into my house looking like that. I took out some hot water, added some hose water to it, made it warm, got her in there, sudsed her up, and it took a whole bottle of shampoo. A whole bottle of Suave shampoo, and it turns out she wasn't dark brown at all. It turns out she was a gold-colored dog. That was a little girl. These were my dogs. These were the ones that I rescued, and I had them on the 80 acres, and they lived their life full measure. I didn't chain them up. I didn't box them up. I didn't beat them. I let them live like dogs. I had enough acreage to where they could run and roam all they want. First, I kept them in a pen to let them know that this was home, and as soon as they realized that this was their pen, I would let them out and walk them around the clearing, and once they realized that this was their home and they don't run away, they had free rein. They were free dogs for the rest of their lives, and every single one of those dogs lived out the full lifespan of their lives. Anywhere from 12 to 15 to 16 years, they lived their lives. They died naturally like regular dogs would die of natural causes, and they were buried there on that property. And I buried them by the garden, by the way, the big garden that I started out with. So I did the best that I can. The thing is, and this is where I'm getting to the point of this program, is that I had a business going, and I was able to support this endeavor. I could afford the best medical care for them. I could afford decent food. I could afford to take some time, spend it with them. I could afford the mortgage on a very large piece of property and a home for these animals. And a thing happened is that during this time, I came down with a condition. And it was depression, and it was stress-related. Stress-related problems along with clinical depression, and it hit me all at once. And I went into forced retirement because I almost died from this. So I was unable, I had to divest myself of my businesses. Mike couldn't handle it alone. So we got rid of the businesses, we sold it, took the money, put it into the bank, and tried to live off of that. But the costs of living there were far too high. And there's a lot of people that don't know this. I didn't want to leave that 80 acres where I had the peacocks and the chickens and stuff. Problem was, I couldn't afford to live there anymore. So I had to sell the place. And I took the last two dogs with me, and we moved to Windom, Minnesota. And that was a hard thing for me to do. And Mike did everything that he could to try and help. He got a part-time job at Walmart, and that just wasn't enough money because we had large bills. And that really didn't help me at all because it was something that I really knew that I wanted to do, and that was my home. And it was also where all of these beautiful, incredible creatures were buried, and I didn't want to leave them there, but we had to do that. So we moved to Windom, Minnesota. That was not the place for me. And then I moved out here to the farm. And because in Windom, Minnesota, I have my YouTube videos. You enjoy the YouTube videos, and I enjoy making them too. It's a great thing. It's a stress reliever. It's a way for me to reach out and connect with people. And when I was living in Windom, Minnesota, that was that little place, you know, with the raised bed gardens and a couple chickens right before I moved here. Well, that wasn't for me, but the nice thing about this is my YouTube program started generating income. And so I started making some money. And that was really nice. And the way that I make money off of my YouTube programs is, in a nutshell, I won't go into the long, drawn-out, boring process, YouTube puts ads on my videos. You see those ads, they're really annoying, but they do this with everybody on YouTube, not just me. People on YouTube have ads on their videos. It's for a reason, not just to tick you off, but every time a video ad runs or somebody clicks on an ad, that creator, which is the person who runs the channel, me for instance, they get a little bit of money, just a few cents, okay? And that adds up. The more subscribers you have, the more views you have, the more you're going to generate off your ad income. Well, YouTube keeps about, I think it was 35% of this money. Okay, they keep it right off the bat. Then you get 65%. Okay, but they're not done yet. There's a company called AdSense. They're the ones that go out and actually get the ads. They keep another 20-something percent of it. So out of all of that, you get very little money out of the ads. But that's okay because there weren't a lot of gardening channels at the time on YouTube, and so the ads paid more. Well, YouTube has grown. There's a lot more people out there, and now they're allowing smaller channels to put ads on there. So the ads are being spread out thinner, and the ad people aren't getting as much bang for their buck, so they're paying less money for ads. And I bring this up because the money that I was making back then allowed me to save up some money and purchase this farm, this old house, and fix it up and stuff. Yeah, it was generating darn good money, and I was very happy about it. Problem is that in the last few years, income has gone down for everybody on YouTube, and it has done the same for me. So it's getting more and more difficult to make ends meet. I'm a retired person, and I'm on a very low fixed income, and the income is actually going down. A lot of people on YouTube have gone the route of opening up a patron page. For those of you who don't know what patron is, it's a website where people can go there and they can pledge donations every single month, either an ongoing occurring donation or a one-time donation. And what the people, the creators of the programs will do is they will make certain videos available just for those patron subscribers. And it's like a bonus for you. And I've resisted doing that for the longest time. And please, bear with me, okay? This is actually good news. I resisted doing that because I made a promise. People have brought this up, Ray, are you ever going to do a patron type of account? And I researched it, and it didn't set right in my gut. I said, no, I promise I'll never charge for my programs. And when I make a promise, I keep that promise, whether it's to my animals, to myself, to my friends. I never break a promise. So I will never charge for my programming. My programming is on YouTube. It's for free. It will always be for free, regardless of what I get paid. But hold on a second. Hold on. I got to restart the camera because I can see my blinking thing. I need to change batteries. Give me just a second. Hey, can you hold still for just a second? My gosh, you think he drank all the coffee? Okay, I want to get back to this because this is very important. Okay, fine, go chase something. He does love me, he really does. But anyway, I wanted to finish this off. It's very important. Remember when Rascal was sick last year? It was that program I called the $1,000 mistake. Well, Rascal had a condition with his teeth, and he also had Lyme disease. Now, I took responsibility for that. You know, you can make excuses, you can blame something. No, I don't do that. That's not right. The buck stops here. I am the caretaker, which means I am the one ultimately responsible, regardless of what happens or how it happens. I am responsible for him, and I take that responsibility very serious. So I took him into the vet, had him diagnosed, and the vet bill was $900 and something. I had $1,000 in my savings account. Not a whole lot. Like I say, I'm a very low income, very retired person. So, I spoke it over with Mike, and we cleared out the savings account and paid the vet. And Rascal's doing fine. Rascal, by the way, is doing beautifully. And it was every penny well spent. I would do it again in a heartbeat, because that's what you do. You take care of the ones that you love, and they take care of you. And Rascal takes care of me every day. I mean, he keeps me sane, keeps me happy, keeps me level, and that's worth everything to me. And plus, his well-being. It's priceless to me. Now, what I wanted to bring up is the patron thing, okay? I have set up a patron account, and that I'm not doing special programming. I want to let you guys know that. I'm not doing any special programming on the patron page. All the patron page is if people would like to assist me in what I do here, and I'm not saying money for me. I'm not buying new sneakers. I'm not buying a new car. There's no clothes. There's no big screen TV. I don't do this for myself, okay? I can take care of myself. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to help the animals that I'm trying to help, and to try to keep everything here going. And the patron page is just a resource for people who would not mind helping out a little. And so you can go there and you can choose to donate a one-time or a recurring thing, like once every month. That's how you that's how it's set up. And all you have to do is hit click, and you can donate anything as small as a dollar. From a dollar on up, whatever you're comfortable with. And you can do that as a one-time thing, or you can set it to every month on the first of the month. It will take that small amount out of your account, and it will donate it onto my Patreon page, and it goes directly to me. And the reason I bring this up is because it's helping to supplement my YouTube income. So I'm not, and I want to make it clear that people who do this out of the kindness of their heart, and they're not doing it to get something that other people aren't going to get. I just don't believe in that. And so that's what I wanted to bring to your attention, is that I now have that outlet, and I'm going to explain why in just a second. It's a very beautiful reason why. But also I wanted to bring it to your attention that I'm not just asking people for their assistance. What I'm doing is I'm pulling myself up by my own tennis shoes, and I'm trying to help out the best way that I can, because we're all in this together. So what I'm doing is I decided, I thought about it, and I thought, what can I do to try to augment, to supplement my YouTube income? Well, the one thing that I do best is I make compost. And people have mentioned that they really like the way that I make compost. And I thought, you know what? It's something that my chickens are working on. So they're working to keep to help out. And so all I have to do is gather that up, mow my lawn, because it has the clover, it has the dandelions, it has the grass, it has all the leaves, it has everything that's well balanced, along with what the chickens contribute. I can make compost, and I make compost like nobody makes compost. And this isn't just the garbage that you buy in the store. This isn't just watered down. This is the full, rich, wonderful stuff that works miracles in my garden. I thought, you know what? I can make this compost, and I could find a way that I can market this, and not market it at a lot of money. Market it at just the lowest amount that I could possibly do it with shipping, and be able to share it with everybody so that they can have good luck in their garden, and they would have it from somebody that I believe that they could trust, because I wouldn't sell anything to anybody that I wouldn't use myself. And I mentioned that before. I don't endorse products. You don't see me endorsing products or anything like that. I just don't do that because I have to have full confidence in it. And I thought, you know what? I have full confidence in my ability to make compost. I have enough confidence in it to use it in my garden. You've watched and saw with your own eyes what I can do with my garden. And I would like to help people do that as well. And one thing I'm doing is I'm using it in my voodoo garden. You know, my other channel, the indoor gardening channel. I made the compost. I heated it up to kill all the organisms in it that could harm anything, like bug eggs and stuff like that. I dehydrated it. Yes, I did. I dehydrated it to make it into this hard, crumbly stuff. And then I ran it through an old food processor that I had in my house. I donated my own food processor. And I crumbled it up into powder, literally powder, like cocoa powder. And that way, it loses all the weight of the moisture. And that way, it's lighter and easier to ship. And it's also something that can be stored indefinitely. You don't have to worry about it going bad. And all you do is you take a small amount, you put it into a bucket, let it set overnight, stir it. The next day, you have instant compost tea with all the nutrients that the original compost had. It doesn't lose the nutrients. It feeds your soil, feeds your plants. So that's what I'm working on for this coming autumn. I'm going to be making the best compost I can, the best I've ever made, and I'm going to market that, and I'm going to be selling that to help raise money, to help the projects that I need to keep going here on the farm, to keep everything going. And also, there was another thing. I wanted to bring this up. This is something that has been inside right here for the longest time. People have asked me questions about myself and what got me started on this path that I'm on. And I gave it a lot of thought. I thought about it for quite some time, and I'm now in the process of it, and it's coming along really nice. I'm writing a book. Yes, I'm writing a book, and it's not going to be an e-book. It's not going to be a little tiny pamphlet. It's not going to be something cheap and cheesy. It's going to be an actual book that you can pick up, you can open up, and read the pages. It's going to be a history of my life starting from day one, and it'll give you an idea of why I do what I do. You know, you see things growing on my property, you see me doing certain things, and you may ask yourself, why does he do that? The book explains things, and it gives you an idea of why I do what I do. There are stories in there that I've never told anybody, because it's kind of hard to tell some of these things. Many of them are funny, a lot of them are crazy, they're fascinating, some are very sad, but it is me. Everything is me from start to finish. I'm typing it up myself, I'm going to self-publish it myself, and I'm going to sell the book myself. There is going to be no middleman in this, because the cost has to be kept down in order for people to get it at a good price. Because I don't want to take people's money and not give them something that's a good value. You know what I mean? And so I want to make sure that this book is, after I take away the publishing costs, I keep a very small profit for myself, and it goes to the projects that I have here going on the farm. But I'm able to bring the book out and share it with people. You're going to love it. You're absolutely going to love it. And it has stories about some of the animals that I've had and some of the things that you've been wanting to ask me. All your questions are going to get answered in it. That, the compost, those are my ways of trying to generate some income. And then I have the Patreon page in order for people, if they would like to donate. I mean, if just a handful of people donated $1 a month, just $1 a month, and had that recur every single month, that's only $12 a year. But the amount of people that that tune in and view, that adds up. That adds up to so much. And every single person, it's appreciated. And I do understand that people have bills to pay. They have lives to lead. And I don't ask for myself. I'm asking for a particular reason. And I would like to show you that reason right now. I was getting to something. And those of you that stuck around to listen to this, I want to show you something. And it's something that's absolutely beautiful. And it touched my heart. Wait right there, and I'll bring it out. Come on out. I want you to meet some people. I have some friends of mine that would like to meet you. Come on down. You're my friends, and I wanted you to be the first ones to meet the new additions to the farm. And I'm just busting. I'm so happy for these two. This one, well, we have to go pee really quick. Hold on a second. Darn it. I tried to figure this out just right. Well, hello there. Yeah, I love you too, babies. I got to show these to you, okay? Hey, come on over here. I want you to meet all my friends out there. This here is Tiki. Thank you so much.
This is Tiki. She is a Chihuahua something mix. Those of you who have dogs, maybe you know more about this than I do. Let me back up, and I'm going to show her to you, okay? She's very shy, and it took me over a week to get her to come to me. She has a bad history, and I'll tell you that in just a moment. She's always shaking, and she's got these beautiful eyes. She's 10 years old. And this one here, this one, this is a Min Pin Chihuahua mix, I believe. This is Tanner. He's 10 years old as well. And he has an issue with his back right leg. And he walks a little funny. Whoops, he walks all over my microphone too. Hey, look at you. But he manages to get around. And so he's a three-legged dog. You're shaking. You're always shaking. Anyway, these two were raised together since they were born in Las Vegas, Nevada. And the woman who owned them, she died. She died suddenly. And so they were left with the woman's husband. The woman's husband didn't want them. He took them to a shelter called Positive Difference. I want to put the name right here. Positive Difference. It's a no-kill animal rescue. They took him in, and all he told them, he gave them very little information at all. He told them, my wife died, and I want to travel. I don't want him. So he just tossed him away. And he also had a cage with some birds, some exotic birds that she had as well. And he didn't want them either. He just gave them all up and wanted nothing to do with them. I just couldn't believe that. A friend of mine on Facebook mentioned this, and I went to their page and I saw the picture of these two. And they're trying to adopt them out and keep them together. And that's really hard to do when you have two old dogs that have medical issues. His leg is deformed, and he was born that way. So he can only walk on three legs. They both have dental issues, and I can't even begin to describe the smell that comes out of their mouth, especially her. It is this horrid, horrid smell. But back to the no-kill shelter. They wanted to try and adopt them out, but that's hard to do. 10-year-old dogs. And one of them's deformed. They have very, very expensive conditions going on in their mouth. The infection, I took them into the vet, by the way, and I'm telling you because that's what the vet gave us the information on. The infection is so severe, they're going to lose a lot of their teeth, and they have to have it done right away before the infection spreads to other parts of their body. And so I have to take them in and take them in for surgery and have them worked on as quickly as possible. So I have an appointment for next Monday to take them in. And they'll take out the teeth. They're going to give them, I have them on antibiotics and to get rid of the infection. But the thing about it is I saw them on Facebook and I thought, you know what? For some reason, it just hit me in the heart. I thought, I meant to take care of these two. I don't know what it was. Something spoke to me. And I posted there, I said, I would take them in a heartbeat, but I live so far away and I don't drive. And the owner of the shelter, she contacted me because so many people saw that I posted on there. They vouched for me. And that, I can't even begin to get into how that made me feel. So many people vouched for me and said Ray would give them such a beautiful home out there. The owner of the shelter volunteered to put them in her car and drive them from Las Vegas, Nevada to Iowa, where I live. That is a 5-day journey, 2.5 here and 2.5 there. So I mentioned it on my Facebook page, and between me and the friends who vouched for me, we raised $600. And that paid for the gas and the motel rooms for her to bring them here and take them back. She didn't make a dime off of this. Nobody made any money off of it. This wasn't about money. But we managed to raise the money to get them here. So I got them for no charge to me. And I didn't know about their conditions before I got them. All I knew is they needed a home. That's all I knew about them. So I took them in, and
I'll give them a good home. They're going to live out their lives happy, healthy, and they have trust issues because I don't know. I can't speak for what happened to them. All I can say is something wasn't good in their lives, all right? That's as far as I'll go with it. They're shy. They back away from me when I try to touch them, which means there was something going on in their lives that wasn't good. He shows it really well, and I want to take a moment here, and I want to show you a clip. Take a look at this.
He looks so sad. He looks like a baby mouse, doesn't he?
Yeah.
All curled up like a little Cheeto.
Yeah, that's sad, and that's how he is. And she stayed in her little bed that came with her. She stayed in her bed. It wouldn't come out. I tried to feed her. She wouldn't eat. She would whine. But for the last week and a half, I've been working with them day in and day out. 24 hours a day I spend with them. I touch them, and look at this. In just a week and a half. This is what love can do for these animals. And this is why I brought up the patron page, okay? I can't do this alone. I need my friends, and they need you as well. And I have the bill, and I'm going to show you the shot, okay? Look at this. It'll be okay. But yeah, it's expensive, and this is going to be a continued thing for me to take care of them, and but it's what I'm going to do, whether I get any kind of help from anybody or not. I'll figure out a way to do this, and they're going to get the care that they need. They're going to get the love that they deserve, and they had a bad life, but it can get better, and it's going to get better for them. So that's why I took the time to come out here in the freezing cold and tell you my story, because I could have just brought them out and shown you, but I had to give you the roots of what I do for these animals so that you can understand it. It's all about knowing why I do what I do, and I do it because I love them and I need to do it for them. So that's why I'm asking you, if you would like to help. I'm going to put the link below, and this is to my Patreon page, and I guarantee you, you have my promise. Everything I raise is going to be going towards them, and also for my other friends. I haven't forgotten them as well. My chicken coop is actually rotting away, that old garage, and I need to tear it down, and I need to build a new one. It's going to be a small one, but I'm going to build it myself, and I'm not going to hire anybody. All of the money that I raise is going to be going to building a chicken coop, and also my porch is collapsing. I know. Everything's falling apart in my life, but you know what? I still find a reason to smile. But it's a good day. Anyway, thank you, everybody, for watching, and I do appreciate your help. I really do. And if you have any questions or concerns, please post them in the comment section below, and be sure to check out the link from my Patreon page. It's right below this video. Click where it says Show More. You'll click that link, and it'll go right there, and I'll be updating you constantly with pictures, videos. They're going to become part of my life out here. I haven't forgotten about Rascal. It's not a matter of splitting up my love between three dogs. I have enough in me for everybody. And this is just the beginning, you know, and this is what I was meant to do. And with some help, I think I'm going to be able to continue, and they're going to be just fine. Okay, I got to get them inside because they're shivering as I'm freezing too. It's very, very cold today. I'm trying not to let my teeth chatter. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much for all of your help, for all of your support, and your continued support. And with a little bit of help from my friends, it's going to be a good day. Ready to go? Okay. Say goodbye, huh?
Say goodbye. Oh, it's a good day. Hold on. Hold on. Come on. Walk it off.